All right, so we should have sound now. Do you guys hear
Hello,
us? All
hello.
right, so we should
Hello.
have
Oh,
sound
shoot.
now.
Hello.
Wait, hold on. My bad. Oh no. I think I messed something up. All right, there we go. I think that should
There's
be
an echo,
okay.
apparently.
Yeah, that's why there was an echo. Is it good? Are we good? Are we dope?
Yeah. All right.
Can we go? Well, I just want to check again the people.
Okay. So
Is the
the
sound good? I don't
screen.
even know. Well, no, I know. I just wanted to check in. Okay, cool. We're good.
All right.
All right.
All
So we're
right.
live. We're live
We're
finally.
about to reveal the amazing Jana and John.
What's
Y'all
up?
ready?
Hey.
Y'all
Hello.
ready?
So, welcome to another Edge Control live stream. It's been, oh God, it's been like a year since we've actually done this. But,
Yeah.
so we're so blessed to have our guest here today with John, Polidora, and
The
Jana
amazing.
Schirmer.
The beautiful
Jana.
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 Woot.
So before we like get into anything, I thought it'd be cool to just briefly talk about Edge Control because I think that there are some people who don't know what Edge Control is. So Edge Control is an event that myself and Savvy here
Hello.
run in Toronto, and this event is an event where we bring six professional artists, Jana included, to come and present to, you guys, like a bunch of people, and we hang out and have portfolio reviews and, have fun. And this event is happening on August 19th and 20th in Toronto. And we could get more into like, where you can get tickets and whatever later. But
Details later.
for
Yeah.
now, it's not about us. It's about these
These
lovely
wonderful
people.
people.
So yes, welcome guys. Thank you again so much for being here. Like this is,
Yeah.
we're blessed.
No, it's a
Just
pleasure.
blessed.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anytime.
Oh God, so much lit in the chat right now.
Yeah, a lot of people are really excited. They're putting fires everywhere in the chat.
I can't
See the chat. I should
Would you
put
like
it
a
up.
link? We'll let you know. We'll let you know what's happening. Right now,
Okay,
it's just a bunch of
please.
hey. Hey, hi.
Hey,
Hey, hi. So, oh,
everybody.
Jamaro's in the chat.
Jamaro's in the
Welcome.
chat too.
Welcome, Jamaro. All right.
And we have Johnny Hall
Yeah.
also.
So, we're gonna relatively keep this a casual stream where we're just chatting. We were chatting earlier, getting to know each other for the most part. But we do have some questions to ask
Yep,
them about
for sure.
art on the stream's behalf. But for now, what's up? What's going
We
on?
like to hear so about you guys, you know, what you've been up to.
Yeah. John, you had a presentation at Edge Control, which was awesome. And like thank you again for coming and
Dude,
streaming
I had so
again.
much fun. I had seriously so much fun. I can't wait to go back to Canada.
Yeah?
Yeah,
Cool.
he told me about it too. I remember you were telling me about that you had a blast there, so I'm excited
Yeah.
too. We'll make sure
Yeah,
you
I love
have the
Canada.
fun
It's
time.
cold.
I'm coming back and I'm not even presenting. I just want to go because I made a lot of cool friends, you
Yeah.
know? Yes,
You'll be
definitely.
doing portfolio reviews, which is awesome. And we
Oh
have
yeah,
like
that's
a.
right. I am doing
Yeah,
that.
thank you for that.
Oh, of course.
Just like more work thrown upon me. But we do have more people doing portfolio reviews this time around. And we're gonna, make a special announcement about that eventually,
Yeah.
later in the stream.
Cool.
But yeah.
Yes.
So
To get things going, Jana would like to hear about what you've been up to and just Oh.
a little intro maybe
Yeah.
if you like to do.
Yeah.
Oh, someone was just asking how come Jana isn't giving portfolio reviews. So Jana's only coming for the first day, I believe.
Yeah, unfortunately, I have a event that we planned for a long time ago, so I can only make it for one day, but yeah, what I can offer is when you go if you go to the event and I can't be there, you could send me your portfolio per email or something, so I can still look at it and give you
Oh,
a
cool.
review about it. Yeah, why not?
Okay, yeah. We could do something about that, definitely. Sweet.
Sweet, sweet.
Awesome.
All right. So we will start off then with some questions, general questions. Either one of you answer or both of you, won't matter. So I'm gonna go deep into this just art stuff, concept art stuff right
Oh,
away.
we're jumping
Let's get this
in
going.
already.
Yeah, we're jumping. We're gonna have to jump in. Just get things going.
Okay.
So, one of the things I've been wondering a lot is how professionals deal with a brief that just doesn't click with them. You know, the something that you're not too fond of, but you have to finish it regardless. I personally have a lot of pain to complete something like that, and it affects the quality of the work a lot. So.
Well, it would be weird if you get hired for something that you're not totally able to do, right? I mean, there's a reason why I never get hired for drawing spaceships or something like that, right? I mean, usually when I get a job, it's probably some kind of illustration with a girl in it.
Right.
So I think I never really had a briefing that I never really feel comfortable with, and even if I feel like it's actually a challenge, you know, so it could be kind
Yeah.
of fun to try something new and do the research and stuff like that. So
What about like early on in your career when you were just starting or breaking in? Did you ever take jobs that you weren't like super excited for, but like you knew that like this was one of your first jobs or something, and it wasn't something that you wanted to do directly?
I think in the beginning you have to take what you have to take whatever is available,
Okay, that's
right?
fair.
Yeah, I think I mean I started out doing comic coloration actually. Like I did stuff for Marvel, for instance. I
Oh,
would
shoot.
just do comic coloration, and but I knew early on that this is not really what I would like to do because it would be just colors and you would be still very limited in terms of you had to really stick to the line art, and it was more like coloring off, like, you know, do you remember this games we could play where you have a picture, there's a bunch of numbers on it, and you have to
Oh,
fit.
the coloring book stuff.
Yeah, exactly. That's kind of how
Oh.
it felt like. So I always wanted to do my own illustrations, so I knew this wouldn't be forever, but for that time being, I think I had it was a good job. It's a good thing to start with, I think.
So what was the first job where you were like, okay, yeah, this is what I was aiming for, like to do?
Good crush. I think everything after the coloring job, I think was pretty fun to do, you know? Yeah. What about you, John?
I'm curious about you.
Wait, what was the question?
We jumped from one question to the other.
Yeah, sorry, I'm a pain in the ass. What'd you guys say?
But what was like one of the first jobs where you were like, yeah, this is exactly what I wanted to do, early in your career?
I think it kind of I had a few of those because it's like my career started out so broad. I think, you know, my first job, I started at Konami, and I'm like, as a kid, that would have made me, you know, just geek out so hard because all of my favorite games were Konami games. And you get there, and reality is a lot different than what you think it is. And then, you know, I think the first real one where it actually felt like, you know, it's like, wow, this is, you know, I'm excited about this, and it actually followed through was like when I, you know, when I started at Blizzard on the WoW team. It was as good as I expected, you know? And then I think every job after that I've taken, I felt the same way. I felt like this is the right thing, but it's like, I've taken a lot of jobs and, you know, I took a job in the beginning that I was like, I had no idea what I was going to do. and it's like, I made a lot of really good friends and I worked on games, but they weren't projects that I was totally into. I was there because it was like, I was hungry.
Okay.
And it's like, no matter what job they gave me to do, and I did a lot of different things there, I just sort of always brought my A game because I was just willing to do whatever they asked me to do to learn whatever I could, because that was my goal, was, you know, to be better than when I walked in the door.
Mm.
And I feel like that's kind of something that I've just always taken with me, you know? So,
but awesome.
You got it. Like, you have to take on sometimes, especially in the beginning, things you don't necessarily want to do, because it'll pay the bills and keep you full, you know?
Mm-hmm. Very true.
Do you find that taking work in the beginning, I guess, does that get you noticed? Like, does that get you a foot in the door very early on in the beginning? Like, people will be like, oh, like, this person is known for this, even though that's not what you intended to do from the beginning. Did that make sense?
Are you talking about typecasting? Is that what you mean?
No. I mean, like when you start out, like, if say that you did a job that you weren't necessarily paid to do, do you feel like you would in turn get jobs based around the work that you were doing professionally that you didn't necessarily mm-hmm. want to do? Or do you feel like
I think personally the stuff that you work on, like you're barely able to show anyway. Like, usually when you work on something, it's still under NDA, and then years later when you actually can show it, like, you probably already work on something else. So
okay.
I think when it comes to work, I have a feeling that from what I observed, it's a lot what you do for your personal work. It seems like a lot of artists get hired for what they do in their free time instead of what they actually do for work, you know, because that's mostly the most I guess unique work, I would say. So
the work that you put out. Okay.
Yeah.
I think for me it's like, you know, if you're only trying to get jobs with what you've done professionally, you're doing yourself a disservice.
Hmm.
Because it's like, don't you want to be able to, you know, determine your own destiny? Because it's mm-hmm. like, in the beginning especially, you're never going to get the chance to necessarily work on exactly what you want to work on. So it's like, how do you make the argument that you're good at something unless you just do it?
Yeah.
So it's like a project-based mentality where you're always working. It's unfair, but, you know, you want to be an artist that remains relevant, that keeps trying to grow. Mm-hmm. You have to keep pushing yourself, and a lot of times the job won't give you that opportunity. You have to make that opportunity happen. And every job I've gotten because I showed I could do something in my own time that was more valuable than what I was doing at the moment, you know?
Yeah
that's my feeling is too.
Interesting.
Also, I know that both of you also have you have a stylized, you have a particular way of working and like a style that kind of comes with it. But I'm curious in retrospect, when you were starting to learn how to do art, did you have any influences that steered you in a direction of like how you developed your workflow and style? Like, unintentionally, it took you in a direction that you didn't necessarily want to go when learning?
Mm. I think for me, definitely when I was starting with like more like a manga style, I was really inspired by manga and anime when I grew up, and Sailor Moon and this kind of things, right?
Yeah.
So, but yeah, but I think when I was posting out online and I came to websites like conceptart.org, and everybody was kind of doing more like realistic and, I don't know, feel more mature at this time of my life, I'm not sure. I think that influenced me a lot, and I think if I wouldn't have looked into that, maybe I would have had a completely different style by now.
Okay.
So
because like you have a distinct way of working.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, man.
I get caught up in this. So anyway.
That's fair. you're doing a great job.
I learned to paint kind of on the job. I think people have heard me sort of talk about this a little bit before, but my teacher was my boss, Glenn Rain, taught me how to paint. And when you're learning, and when somebody's mentoring you, you can't help but learn, be influenced by the style that you're emulating, because it's like, it's easier in the beginning to learn another way that definitely works, has a repeatable process that you can emulate, than it is to come up with a process that works for you. So it's like, in the beginning, I was just learning how Glenn painted. And I figured out, and you know, I wasn't able to do necessarily what he could do, but it gave me a starting point. And you know, I mean, a lot of the stuff I've done for Blizzard over the years was, you know, not necessarily on point with like how I like to work or how I like my work to look, but it's still valuable. I mean, and honestly, like even to this day, it's still, if that, all that experience and even that process is sort of evolved into what I do now. So
are you still trying to evolve the process that you have, or do you feel like you're settled? Okay.
I still do. Like if I find a better, faster way, or, you know, just a way that will give me an a look or an effect that I think is more in tune with what I'm with, something that, you know, a direction I want to take my art, then absolutely I'll try it.
Okay. Have you ever like tried to completely break away from your current workflows and like do something that is completely, you know, foreign to the way that you do things? Like looking at the way, I don't know, I can't make a good example, but
for me it's I really like to try more traditional stuff lately instead of working on the computer all the time. I mean, I've got the iPad, right? And I love drawing digital wherever I can. But for some reason right now, I really enjoy doing watercolors and stuff like that.
Okay.
Wow. I need to see some of those.
Yeah.
Oh, don't expect much. It's just...
No. You say that, but they're probably awesome.
Oh, no. The pressure.
Your stuff on Instagram is great, like your traditional work there, like the brush pen stuff, the inks, those are fantastic.
Thanks.
Yeah, of course.
Definitely enjoy that. We have a lot of questions from the chat piling up now. So we can get to them on and off. Yeah, so the first question was, what was your favorite project you've worked on by Art Stuff?
All of them.
Maybe JP will go first because I have to think about it.
Wait, what was the question? Don't worry about it.
So Artsoft asked, what is your favorite project you've worked on so far?
Easy, Overwatch.
Overwatch. Yeah.
Awesome. That's a good one.
Yep.
People have like their lives stolen from that game.
It was the best team I ever worked on, at least so far in my career. I had a ton of fun, so that was easy. That's an easy one.
Do you play Overwatch?
Not so much. I don't really game as much as I would like. I mean, I'm more like art all the time.
Yeah, that's fair. I haven't played a game.
That's good.
In a long time. Yeah.
All right.
I think for me it's, I can enjoy. For me, it's never really about a project. Like I'm not. There's a lot of, when I ask people or friends around if they have a job they would love to do, you know, they can really fanboy or go around something, you know. But I honestly don't really have anything that I feel super excited about, like in terms of a project or a company. Usually it's from picture to picture, you know, there might be pictures I really enjoy doing, or it's more from the artwork itself instead of the project. Like I don't usually care too much about the project itself, more about the work, you know?
Yeah. Do you feel
that
like
makes sense?
Do you feel like there was a place where that gave you the most artwork that you enjoyed personally?
Yeah. That's a lot. Like, I usually, like, unless there's a few exceptions, I have not, I can't complain about my work. Like, I think I'm still, even if I do complain sometimes, like, I still think I'm super happy that I'm able to do this for a living, you know? I think this is just amazing, you know, that I can basically do what I would do in my free time anyway and get money for it, you know? This is pretty cool. So I'm pretty grateful for whatever it is usually.
It's a really nice way to look at it. We are lucky to be in this industry.
It really is about perspective, I feel. People who just don't get that chance to find what they like to do in the beginning, and people who don't even know like that things like this are, you know, possible to
So there was a question specific to Riot, and I do believe, John, you can't really answer those kind of questions.
I would just prefer not to.
Right. So just for,
I mean, I'm really new there, and the point is for me to keep my job.
Yes.
I haven't gone through any kind of training for that kind of thing. So ask me art stuff. Art stuff for sure.
Congrats, by the way.
I'm loving it there.
Yeah, we were talking about it earlier.
Yeah, definitely. Congratulations on that. It's a huge thing.
Some exclusive information.
Wonderful place to work. I'm really we talked about it a little bit before, like, we went live, but I'm really, really enjoying it there.
Yeah. So.
All right. I can ask the next question. Yeah, there's it's coming and going. So, Boris, he asks, what's the secret to tight, clean illustrations, Jana? Is it simply rendering for a long time, or is there any tricks to speed up the process, including the background or something?
To do clean illustrations?
Clean. And
clean.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what that means.
Jana, your illustrations are so super awesomely clean.
Clean? I don't know. Like, I feel like they're almost too clean. Like, it's funny because when I work on something, I find, like, a lot of time in the end I spend on roughing up edges because I have this too clean computer look, you know, like, because I do a lot of selections and then I end up with this really hard edges and it looks really, it doesn't look really painterly, I guess, so I don't really like it. So
yeah,
for me, it's not necessarily a good thing. But I mean, thank you for thinking I take it as a compliment, I guess.
It's really interesting, though, that you have trouble with having messier edges than clean, and a lot of people is vice versa.
Yeah, I mean, I like this more painterly look, but I don't know about you guys, but usually what you do for work is not what you actually like, you know? Like, I think my style, what I like as artworks, it's really different from what I actually do. I don't know about you, if that's
actually, you know, I remember that you made a post on Facebook like a while ago. I think I might be paraphrasing it, but it was talking about how you weren't feeling good about your work from like a stylistic point of view, and like the stuff that you liked was more, I don't know, simplistic in composition or like something like that. And I was wondering, has that, like, have you changed, like, did anything change since then, and like, have things felt any different for you?
I'm not sure, like, I'm still thinking that I'm on a journey to to enjoy painting again, because I don't know, I think, I don't know how many people are in the chat who are mostly starting out or who are doing this for a while. I feel like, you know, when you start working and it's, everything is really exciting and you just love doing it, but it's, at some point you kind of feel like burning out, or you kind of feel like you lost your motivation and what you like, the things that motivated you in the first place might be not the same, you know. So I don't know, it's it's hard to say. Like I'm not actively changing something right now. I just try to get back into having fun and working on my personal projects a little bit more, you know, because I think that can be a good way to find the joy in painting and drawing again.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to focus on that. Yeah.
Is there anything in like particular that you do that you feel like, okay, yeah, this is what, like you're reminded of, like why you started to do this or why you want to do this? Or has it just kind of been all over the place?
Yeah, I'm still trying to figure it out for myself. I mean, there's also the part where I still have to make money, so I'm still going to keep working, because working for me never was a problem. Like, I can always work, you know. It's more like finding the thing that I actually really care about and want to do by myself. So this is a bit harder to find, you know.
Yeah.
So, but I've been working on some small projects I will post it about in the future. It's nothing big, but it's something, you know, small things that I really enjoy working on and that I get excited about, you know. So yeah, it's nothing nothing crazy, but
looking forward to that. So we can move forward to the next question though. All right, so Drive by Uppercut CJ, he asks, when you're having issues with your development or reaching a plateau in your work, how do you deal with it? This can apply to either you or John. Doesn't matter.
If John listens for me. terrible. Sorry.
No, don't worry about it. Both of you are making amazing work, so I'm surprised how you're talking in the first place.
It's a struggle.
What was the question? I'll answer it if you want. I just
So the summary is that you know, how do you deal with plateau after you know, you're having issues with developing your skills or stuff like that?
Usually, like for me, I would say I just try to do something pretty different. Okay. Like I don't tend to show everything I do. So it's like a lot of the times I'm taking a chance, you're not seeing it, but like I mean, like that was in the past. Now it's like if I want to take a chance, I just take a chance and I'll put it up. But in the past, it's like if I felt like I was plateauing, I would purposefully do something different.
Okay.
Like otherwise, or would you just, you know, maybe start doing something completely different that has not even anything to do with art?
Both, actually. That's a good point. I would sometimes, like in the past, I would just like, well, I'll try a different process or I'll try a different aesthetic, and that's one way to go, and it does work sometimes. But then the other thing is like well, maybe I'll take up a different thing I'm not good at. That's what I started doing recently. Like I took up cooking, and I took up I started playing pool with some friends, and
hey.
I suck at pool, but I love sucking at pool. You know,
same.
It's like, it. There's nothing like the perspective of a new experience to kind of make going back to art feel new.
Yeah,
and I feel like that feeling is what gets you over plateaus more than necessarily any gigantic aha realization moment. So it's, you know, it's perspective, I think.
I feel like that's why hobbies are so important, because like you could be like, they're professional fishers, but you could just, you know, go out and fish and suck at it. But it kind of feels good to like have those micro, like, oh, like that's how, like getting better, like micro transactions.
The problem arises when your hobby becomes your career. Like, art was my hobby. Now I'm just like doing it 24/7, and when I'm not doing anything, I'm just sitting, I'm just being. Like, what do I do?
Yeah.
I think there's just a lot of value in trying something new. Because it's like, it doesn't take away from your art. And honestly, like, sometimes growth that happens from those times is more significant than if you just tried to muscle your way through, you know, because it's like sometimes you need to recharge.
Yeah.
You can't just rely on, I'm going to figure this out if I sit with it long enough. But, you know, sometimes going to a museum or, you know, just changing your environment, even if like you're still drawing or whatever in someplace else, or is if you're changing something about your everyday, you're going to find inspiration, even if it isn't necessarily, even if you don't feel it right away. Mm-hmm. It will affect you. You just need to kind of change something, anything. Try changing something, and it doesn't have to be art.
Right.
Yeah, I think also there's a saying that without any input, there's no output, right? And mm-hmm. I think that's really true. Like if you maybe at some point you need to focus on something completely different. You know, sometimes I get really frustrated because there's something I feel like I'm not able to do, and something that's really annoying me. And instead of just keep trying, sometimes you just have to stop, you know, because you're just making it worse sometimes, I feel like. So just having a break, it's maybe not the worst thing. And then you can have a fresh start afterwards. Hmm.
Do you guys feel like breaks, like how important have breaks been for you? Like, because I think for a lot of people, especially when you're starting out, I think a lot of people have this mindset like, oh, I have to be doing this 12 hours a day like everyone else is who's starting out. Otherwise, I won't get to the place where I want to. Do you feel like breaks are important when you're starting out or when you're later, you know, in your career? Or do you feel like it's important all around?
Well, I think it's if you have this passion in you and this motivation in you that you have to draw and you have to produce stuff, that's great. Just, you know, go for it. Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that might be this rare things in your lifetime where you actually feel like this. You know, if you have a job and you do that every day, you might not feel the same motivation, actually. So mm-hmm. I think go crazy and go for it. But I also think you shouldn't be too hard on yourself. And I feel like what a lot of people forget is to have fun. You know, like I feel like it's really hard to forget that to have fun is actually helping you a lot, because then if you have fun, you're actually going to produce more stuff automatically. Otherwise it just becomes a hassle, you know, and something you have to do, and then it actually becomes work. But as long as you can keep the fun in doing things, I think it can be a huge advantage.
Yeah,
that's true. So a lot of people tend to forget the purpose behind the art
they do
in general. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But that's complicated because, I mean, the reason why you started doing art in the first place might be not the same later, you know, like it might change. And that, I mean, for me, it feels like you kind of have to find always new reasons why you like to do it, you know. So, sorry, I interrupted you, I think.
It's totally good. This is a stream about you guys. We want to hear more from you.
Okay.
I think taking breaks is important. It totally is. But it isn't the act of the break, and you don't really see the value of it in the moment of the break. You feel the value of it after.
Mm.
Definitely.
That makes a lot of sense, actually. Because I feel like people don't let themselves take breaks. Like, maybe they'll like procrastinate, but in the back of their heads they're like, oh, I should be drawing right now. I'm wasting time. But when you do that,
I've got news for you, that never goes away.
Yeah.
Lord.
True.
Great.
Yeah, great. I personally have been doing that too. Like I felt a huge burnout, but I feel if I keep doing work, maybe I'll just get over it, just forget it or something. But it affects the quality of work and also slows down everything I do. So I think like taking a break is definitely a way.
Yeah. I mean, and you know, I mean, I don't know what the average age is of the chat right now, but I just assume that most of the people are probably really, really young, like maybe in their 20s. So you guys have time, you know, like I feel like it's so funny when I see kids, you know, like I don't know, like 70-year-old or something, and they're like stressing out that they're not good enough or like haven't achieved anything in their eyes or whatever, you know. But dude, you have time. You don't stress it too much.
It takes years to get where where you guys are, especially.
I guess I feel why some people might be panicking, because there are these like kids, superstars working in the industry already, and right. That's
like 6-year olds professionals.
Yeah,
just,
like
killing it.
Yeah, but it's like there's always gonna be people who are better than you, right? Like
yeah,
that's just how it is. Just... yeah, it's always gonna be somebody who's better and younger than you, so it's not too much reason to stress about that.
Yeah, that's fair.
Well, you gotta ask yourself why you're doing it in the first place. True. If you're really that competitive, like, it's not, you're in the wrong field, honestly. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, I think sometimes people succeed because they're competitive, but I honestly think the people that I know that are really the best at this, you know, the best in our field are the ones who are only ever really competing with themselves.
Yeah.
You know? It just doesn't make any sense to me to kind of ever measure yourself up to somebody else. As it's like, yeah, there is always going to be somebody better than you. There always will be. And they're probably like, that was probably the mentality for artists long before, you know, when we were alive.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I'd imagine it's better to put all the energy that you're spending comparing to people into the work itself. Like, make that good rather than thinking, why am I so bad?
Yeah. I think too that, it's probably not the healthiest attitude to have to look at other people and asking why are they so good, and or like I want to give up drawing because it doesn't make any sense because everybody else is so much better than me. I mean, if you can try to get motivated instead of, you know, like maybe if you can take motivation out of it instead of pushing you down, you know. But it's easier said than done, I guess. So.
Yeah. No, I'm just of the mind that like if you're not having fun at any point, like in terms of like when you're struggling, this is not the career for you. You know, mm-hmm. You've got to have a certain degree of enjoyment in the understanding the acceptance of failure. Mm-hmm. You know, because no one walks into this doing it well right away.
Right.
Everyone fails. It's the people that fail and then continue to go and accept the failure and move past it that actually succeed. And so many people give up as soon as they fail that it's just like, well, you know, if that happens, this is not the job for you. Mm-hmm. You know?
Very true.
Yeah, I can attest to that. All right. Are there any other questions from the chat?
Yeah, I have saved quite a few of them. So I'm going to butcher the names, so I'm sorry for that. Lian Pochen or something? So the question was, can you give any suggestions to find out your own art styles? Like, how do you find your own art style?
I guess that's something that comes to you naturally. I mean, everybody has their own style in a way, even if you don't think you do have, you know. I'm sure there's something in your art that you do that's really unique to you. Like, nobody draws the same, right? There's always something that makes it look, okay, this is definitely you. So I don't know if that's the answer to the question. I feel like I missed something.
No, it's a very hard thing to answer in general, because we don't know why we draw the way we do. Like, if everyone studies in one class, studying the same thing, they all will come out different. People still have difference in them. And like, I personally have been told that I have quote-unquote style, but for me, it's just because I have limitations in my skill, and that limitation makes a specific thing in my work, and that's it.
I don't know. I think there's so many variables to that. That's the problem, right? Like, I think for the most part, style, you either have to decide for yourself, like, okay, I'm going to draw like this person or that person, or I'm going to draw anime in this specific way. or as you grow and develop, the things that ring true to you as you develop becomes part of your quote-unquote style. Like, if you think that this, like a hand should be rendered in a certain way, or like this should be rendered in a certain way, like the decisions that you make as you grow and develop kind of accumulate into a style, I suppose. Yeah. But that's just the way that I've looked at it.
Yeah. What do you think about this? Sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm just, I think style maybe might be not so important either, you know, for if you do professional work, it's, I think, skill is maybe something you can detach from style. So I guess that's more important, how you're able to work on an assignment. You know, it's not so much about your style, but more about the execution. And that might be different from your style, I guess. Yeah, sorry.
But I think there are situations too where style is important as well. Like if you're working for, say, Blizzard, I feel, is there like a specific style requirement, you know?
I mean, I think for me, like, style, you just do it in the beginning and you don't understand why. But you spend long enough kind of taking the thing apart and you can put it back together however you want.
Okay.
And I was at a local college talking recently, and I realized something. I told the students that were asking about something similar to this. I was like, what artist inspires you? And they're like, this artist, that artist, that artist. And I was like, well, do you know why? And they're like, their art is cool. I was like, no. What about what consistencies are you seeing in each piece that relate to the style that you could literally list as factors, right? That you would say, these are the aspects of this art that inspires me. I guarantee you there's some crossover from that to your own work every time, because those are the things that you are inspired by. The more aware of that you are, the more you'll be able to control it.
I see. That's interesting. I never thought of it that way.
Most people haven't.
That's why we have you here.
So wise.
No, I'm just
wise.
I just thought I'd share it because I realized that recently.
I see. Okay. Right.
This sort of relates. The next question was by Green Pea is good. Yes, it is good.
No, it's not.
Yeah. Amazing. So who is your current inspirational artist? So who do you look up to?
There's so much. I mean, it would be like take the whole live stream to try to put everybody in it, you know?
Just whatever names are at the top of your head right now, you don't have to go any further with it.
So much, really. I mean, I think especially nowadays with internet and Facebook, like you are constantly, you know, overwhelmed with amazing pictures and artists, you know, like on Instagram or Facebook. I mean, it's really hard to name a few. I mean, sorry, but I refuse to do that. It would be not fair.
John?
We'll get on
I think a lot of the artists that I look up to are people that I actually call friends, and I'm not going to mention names.
Cool.
You know, just because it would be weird, and they know I love them, so it's just, yeah, I'm not going to do that.
So
I'm not going to do that.
Green tea is good. We're sorry.
Look at your friends.
Sorry, green tea. But I like green tea, so maybe that's okay.
Good name.
It's a good name.
Yeah. Just a heads up. It's scheduled to end around 11:30. Then that's like 15 minutes left. But
what?
It's up to you guys if you'd like to
keep
it going.
Painting all night.
Yeah, I mean, I can paint.
Yeah.
Huh?
Okay. So we can go until like 12 then, if that's cool with you guys.
Yeah, whatever.
I'm okay.
Awesome. That's cool. So the stream will be going on longer, guys.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
So, So Johnny Hall.
Oh.
My boy.
I remember that guy.
Johnny Hall asks, will Jana be doing mentorship soon?
Oh.
Like,
damn.
Actually, I had some requests about mentorships. Like, you mean like private mentorships, or I guess, wait.
Let's say like a class or a mentorship.
Online.
Yeah,
I've
been thinking about doing like a one-to-one kind of things, you know, but I am not really sure about this. Let's see how much time I have for this. But I mean, it's definitely something that I've been asked to in the past. So maybe it's something I should consider, you know?
Okay. I'm going to be on that.
Please put me on the list.
Put me on the list too.
thanks for the question. That's nice of you to ask.
I know you mentioned it earlier, John, that you weren't sure about teaching, but have you ever thought about having a class or a mentorship?
No.
No?
I'll reiterate, I'm really selfish with my spare time.
That's fair. No, that's important too. That being said,
though, like, if anybody ever wants to talk about art, I'll talk for free. You know, like, art discussion is seriously, it's one of my favorite things. So it's like, reach out to me on Facebook, pose a good question. You know, seriously, I'm always available, like, to talk about art. That's seriously, that's something I love. So even though I won't teach, I love talking about it. So.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Yeah.
Sick.
Good stuff. Sick. So some of the questions are a little specific to techniques. I'm gonna leave that for now, and maybe we can talk about something more broad. So one of the other questions I was thinking of asking is, have you ever felt inconsistency in your artistic abilities? Like, sometimes you just feel like you can't seem to do the things you already know. And if so, how do you deal with that?
I'm not sure if I understood the question, sorry.
The struggle question, I think, right?
Yes, it's struggle? More about struggle.
How do you deal with, like, struggling with something that should be easy?
Oh. it's funny, I was, like, every 2 weeks I'm doing this portrait drawing with friends of mine. Mm-hmm. And so we would meet in a coffee place and draw each other, basically. And it's so funny, like, sometimes I feel like so inconsistent, you know, like, there's, for instance, sometimes I'm able to do a portrait that I actually feel like, oh yeah, it's not too bad. And then I do one after and it totally sucks. Like, it really, it's so bad. Like, there's a huge gap of quality between those two. Hmm. So I feel like it's really frustrating, you know, because if you're able to do a kind of decent portrait, then you should be able to do it again. But I guess it's not the case, you know. Otherwise, it's annoying. But I mean, I don't know how to deal with it. I mean, that's how you know that you get better. That you're like accidents. Like, you're a lucky accident. Just get more and more. You know, like. You might be drawing and then you might have a good picture and you're kind of happy with, and the more you get those moments, the better you get. And maybe that's what it is, you know?
Yeah.
Because I've had struggles exactly like that where it's the same project, just the same type of character stuff.
Yeah.
But suddenly you just can't do it.
Yeah, totally. I had that too. I don't know what to do about that. It's really annoying when that happens, but I guess part of the process of getting better.
Do you ever have that feeling where, like, you'll do something amazing, you feel like is amazing, but then do you ever feel like after doing something that's relatively good, then like you have to prove it again, like the feeling of having to now I have to start all this over again, and now I have to like did I really pull that off, like, or like, you know?
I've got news for you. Oh, go ahead, Jana.
No, I'm excited about your news now.
I'm just saying, I've got news for you. Like, that's like professional art life.
Mm-hmm.
You know? You're always expected to do better than what you just did. Mm-hmm. That's just mm-hmm. how it is. So it's like, get used to that. It's a healthy mentality to have. It's like, it's one of those things that's just going to keep driving you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but even if it's not expected from work, let's say if you do something completely on your own, you know, like as a study or whatever, you know, in personal work, it's, you still experience this, like differences in,
yeah.
in quality, and that can be really annoying. But I mean, I have that all the time too. But I guess there's good and bad days. So I guess you just need to keep going. You can't be too, demotivated by that.
Okay. I think that those can be sort of staved off too by taking enough time off. If you're having one, it means you haven't relaxed enough. Usually, like, you stress, you'll feel better. Okay. Take a step away.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
You still have more questions.
Yeah, there's a lot of questions from the chat.
Hey, chat.
Hi, chat.
They're also complimenting you guys a lot. They like the lighting, they like the color and everything. So, yay. Aww.
Thank you.
Okay, the next one. Chagawo is the username. So what is your opinion on working on your portfolio for a specific studio? Any advice or tips on what to do?
Maybe it's a good question for JP, since I mean, I haven't really worked in a studio. Like I worked in outsourcing studios, but I've never worked in a big company, so maybe that's a good question for JP.
Wait, what was the question?
The question was...
I'm sorry.
Don't worry about it. So basically, your opinion on working on your portfolio for a specific studio, any advice on that or tips on what to do?
I think it's definitely a successful way to go about doing things. It's not really... always as rewarding as you would, as like, you know, you'd like, unless you're an enormous fan of the work of that studio, which mm-hmm. a lot of times, you know, people are. So, I mean, that might be awesome, might be perfect for you if that's what you want. But, mm-hmm. I mean, like, you will get jobs if you're showing them work that looks like something they could use right away, you know, like, mm-hmm. no doubt about it. If you're performing at a level that's usable to them, then you'll get work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, from what I heard too, it's a good thing to, if you want to apply to a specific studio, to just you know, make your portfolio, adjust your portfolio to it, you know, like also I see a lot of people have studies in their portfolios and stuff, and I don't think that sometimes it's really helpful to have.
That's true.
I think
that's go ahead.
No, that's fine. Being polite.
Well, I was just going to say I'm polite too, but we can't play this game all night. So I was just about to say, I've seen, so this might actually just apply for people that are looking to work specifically in the studio at all times, because there have been people with completely different style, and they're still hired on projects where more than their work, their ideas are being used.
Oh.
No, it's just a statement.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
So, next question. Lian Pochin, again. Sorry, I butchered your name. So, question to John, do you have any tips for designing characters out?
Yeah, just tips. Well, have a point to it. Figure out what you're designing before you design it. Like, try to get as connected to like a potential story before you start drawing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's nothing like having a plan to at least start, you know, building on what your expectation could be, because it's I don't know, writing and art tend to go hand in hand. So
yeah.
The more information you have, the better an idea you'll have. Even if it's something that's just really abstract, the more, it's going to sound strange, but the more limitations you put on yourself, the better it's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. I find that too. I know that when I've done work, like for myself, like I tend to leave it open-ended for the most part, because I'm looking for, I don't know, authenticity or something, some bullshit like that. But then I find like it my work doesn't become grounded when I don't give myself like a set amount of limitations or parameters. Like, even if I don't, like in the beginning where I'm not like super excited about the parameters that I set, my work tends to come out more favorable than if I were to just, you know, go off and try something random.
I can keep going with the questions, or
do it.
Gotcha. So okay, so Anti-Government Steve says, what's the best method for learning to choose the right colors or color matching when drawing from life?
When this is a Jana question, because I don't draw from life.
You don't? I think the best way to choose colors, if you draw from life, the best color choice is probably the one that you see, right? I mean, that's kind of the point, I guess. I mean, you can also stylize it, but I think for learning, I think it could be good exercise to try to make the colors as realistic as possible. So really try to look and see what colors it is, you know? And what I experienced too with drawing from life, like sometimes it can get really frustrating because the first 20 minutes or so, it looks like shit. You know, you have to accept that what you do probably looks like shit. And then the more you continue, though, the better it gets. So you have to keep up and keep drawing on it. So because sometimes the colors you see, you can only see in relation to other colors, right? So if you see a color and it looks like greenish, it could be a totally different tone if you add the colors around it to it. So if I do studies from life, I try to put the general color idea onto the screen first, onto the drawing or painting first, and then you adjust every color individually again until you feel like, okay, that's now I got it right, or sorta, you know. That's how I would do it.
What do you feel like is the benefit to drawing from life as opposed to pictures? Or,
I think I learned so much. Like, I feel like it really, but I have to do it more too, because I feel like whenever I paint from life, it helps me so much. Like, I feel like before I was drawing from life, I never really thought about materials and the different behavior of materials, unless I actually started to do life studies from like metal and all that kind of stuff, because to have it in front of you and to see how things react with light and changing your position and stuff like that is completely different than just using a photo or like things like this. So I mean, okay. This is usually what I recommend people if they want to learn drawing or painting, like do studies from life, because it's gonna benefit you so much.
I see. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I guess.
Hear that, JP?
No, there's value in it. I just tell you that, like, my experience doing that was entirely uninstructed. I got nothing out of it because no one explained the value in it.
I see.
So it's, for me, I'm more observational. Like, I'll look at something, be inspired by it, and want to paint something that makes me want to paint, or something that, you know, it's like, I don't really use reference the same way a lot of people, I think, use reference. I will look it up, put it on my screen for a second, and then I will get it off the screen as quickly as I possibly can. Because I don't like being affected by what exists. I want my impression of what exists.
But you also are doing, like, you're really doing very stylized and fantastical kind of illustration, right? So,
well, granted, it could be a lot better if I understood reality. But it's like, this is just the way I've learned, and I'm old, so, you know.
Not that old.
No, I'm pretty old.
You look like you're 20.
Yeah, he does. I'm not.
You go to school with me. So then, in that vein, when you reach to a certain level in your work, how does learning differ from when you're starting out, or even when you're just like reaching a professional level?
I think there's not really a difference to that, you know.
Okay.
It's always gonna be kind of the same. Like, you never stop learning.
Right.
I think for me, it's like, you know, the longer you do it, the more you know how to teach yourself.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
You know.
Right.
And it's like, then it becomes streamlined, and you no longer have to, because it's like when you start learning anything, you start learning by the world's way to be taught, which is like, sit in a classroom, do what you're told, do your assignment, hope you learn something, come back in, show the class what you did. You know, that bullshit really never worked for me with art. It worked academically, because it's like, it's very easy to repeat the answer that you get from, from a teacher in a classroom, as long as it's something that isn't interpretable like art.
Right.
You know, if it's a fact-based thing, it's pretty easy to, you know, just repeat an answer. But if you're trying to learn something that you're gonna, you know, interpret and, you know, have your own voice with it, it's the way that they teach in school typically isn't going to teach you anything other than, hey, this is what people have learned. Hey, this is a way to do things. These are theories that some people have, you know, that might make you more successful. But most of the time, no one teaches you why some things work.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's like, it's really important to just focus on that aspect. It's like, okay, I'm doing this. Why am I doing this? What does this net me? Okay, I'm making this mistake. Why am I making this mistake? I don't know, self-awareness is probably the best teacher, you know?
What if you don't have self-awareness? Like, what if people simply just can't, like, see what's wrong with their work, and they continue to do the same thing over and over? Like, how do you get out of that?
Because anyone who thinks that way should not be, should not feel that way. I'm sorry, no one is perfect. Right. It doesn't matter if, like, been told your entire life that you're special. I got news for you. There's always somebody better. Always.
Absolutely.
Okay, so it's better for you to accept that, like, even if you can't see them, that you have flaws. And that acceptance that you could be wrong will make you better.
Very good answer.
Yeah.
Honestly. And that's the main thing I would like to find out about you and Jana, because there are a lot of questions that go into specifics, like, oh, how to value, how to this, but more importantly, I would like to know how you go about thinking about things. What's your mentality like when you're going to study? Because a lot of the answers are always there, and every artist answers, you should do studies, you should do this, you should do that. But in a lot of ways, it matters on how you're thinking about the study in general, and what goes through your head while you're drawing in general.
I think when you want to learn something, it's not so different from any other thing you want to learn. I just realized that, you know, for instance, if you want to learn another language, for instance, you start by learning the vocabulary, right? And you look at it, and then you try to remember the vocabulary, and then do it over and over again, and at some point you have to speak it, you know. Like, it's not enough just to look at your vocabulary and think that's all you need. You also have to apply it, you know. So, and that's the same thing with drawing, you know. You can, when you do studies, I feel like it's not gonna help you unless you try to apply what you just learned, you know. Like, if you want to learn how to draw an elbow, you know, you can make thousands of studies drawing an elbow, but it's not gonna do much if you not try to do that elbow out of your imagination afterwards, you know, like do studies and then try to do the same thing from imagination.
Yeah, I've seen some of your study work, and I remember there was one where you had like a forearm that was like rotating in a wheel in perspective. And like, was that something that you...
I had that?
I think so. It was, I don't really remember. It was like a rotating forearm or arm or something. I don't know.
Think you, and maybe,
but
I think...
Maybe it was something. But...
So are you really her fan? Are you really her fan?
I am. She was one of the first people I looked at on DeviantArt, actually.
Ah.
Yes.
I know. So cheesy. But I think in that vein, it's important. Like retention studies is absolutely important to do.
Yeah.
Because I know that I've done studies where my mind blanks. For example, and like you think mm-hmm. that you take in the information, but in reality, like it just doesn't happen. Like,
yeah.
And I also think intention when you're going to apply the study helps too. Cause like, I know that I'll draw the same torso over and over and I'll be like, oh yeah, I know how to draw torsos. But unless I like put it in a context where like the torso is, it has to be in a very particular position or it has to be drawn a certain way or whatever. I don't think I, like, without that, I wouldn't have learned anything. I wouldn't know if I learned anything or not.
Mm. Yeah, right. Like, go on and try to apply. That's important, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Right. Okay. So, I'm out of questions. I have none.
There's plenty to go through still. So, again, Leon Pochin. So... Jana and John, do you think people can learn more things by doing fan art than own stuff?
If they can learn more things?
From fan art than your own work.
I think whatever makes you draw, you know, whatever makes you be excited and think and stuff, it's gonna benefit you in any way, you know?
Yeah.
Mm.
I think it'll fan art might get you good at some things. It'll definitely get you good at if the point is to absorb the style and the reasoning behind why a character looks the way it does. Mm. Sure, but I don't know if it's more specific in getting you better at something than having your own voice.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
You
know?
Yeah.
I actually made it a list item for something I wanted to do this year that I want to do more fan art because it's fun.
Yeah.
And I mean, I think ultimately, like, if you're having fun, maybe it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
True.
That's a good point, actually.
That's what I think, too.
Sick. Sick nasty.
Right.
CJ. All right.
So, Chigawo. I'm sorry. How would you study design?
Ooh,
how would you study design?
I would see what's already there. Like when you, for instance, if you want to become a really good fantasy illustrator, maybe I would study things that's already been there. You know, because like in terms of historically, there's so many interesting. Armors and stuff like that already existed, you know, that people came up with. And I would study that first before you get too inspired by video game and novel and fantasy stuff from nowadays, you know, because already people came up with really cool stuff hundreds of years ago, you know.
Yeah, look up the inspiration of the inspiration.
Ooh. Yes, exactly.
Yeah. You go eventually go back to cave paintings. Study cave paintings. That's where you get your inspiration.
I would say though,
Oh no, it's fine.
No, go ahead.
I think design is totally different than being good at rendering things. Mm. It's a totally different skill set, and that is almost entirely not something that you get from practice. I think it's something that you get from understanding, and people can be naturally good at design and never drawn a day in their life. They can just naturally understand the flow of idea and how to guide the eye through something or how to communicate something abstractly. It's not something that you necessarily have to can even approach the same way you can being like somebody who renders amazing art. I think it's a slow burn thing that even a lot of really, really great artists nowadays, probably they think you might not think it, but they think they're weak on design. And it's because design is a lot harder, because there's no firm rules as to what's right and wrong. It's just like sometimes you know it's effective and you can't explain why. I think that's, like I said, it's why I spend so much time thinking why things are successful, you know, trying to take a thing apart and figure it out, because I want to know what that truth is, so that it's like, so I have it, and then if somebody asks, I can share it.
Right.
You know.
Do you have any subjective opinions about design? Like, what do you consider to be good design? I suppose. Well, I think the context varies, but like, is there an overall kind of rule that you have?
Are you saying examples of good design, or are you saying universal truths? I think like a universal truth for me, it would be like, ultimately we can spend our entire lives trying to get good at design, and ultimately like the audience will still determine what successful is. Mm-hmm. And you might not be able to take apart why it works, but it does. There's that. But for me as an artist, it has to, like, a perfect design has to work as a composition. It has to, you have to be able to say all of the aspects that you've chosen in the design are working to focus the eye towards the point of interest that you deem most important. And then maybe you have a hierarchy, so you're moving the eye around the design in a way that tells the audience something that even they're not aware of, you know. Mm-hmm. I feel like good design does that without ever having to explain it. Yeah. You know,
that's
like, that's really such a broad thing too. Like, that doesn't only apply, because I feel like that definition people will take for like, oh, that's applicable to illustrations or environments, but I find like that is also prominent in character work as well.
It's honestly, I think it's true in everything.
Yeah.
Everything. Like advertisement, it's true in product design, architecture. It's a design truth. It transcends just like drawing and painting. That's why it's harder, because we spend our entire lives trying to be good at drawing and painting, but design is an entirely different animal.
Yeah.
And they do not teach it in school. They teach you how to do what other people have done and deemed successful, but there's not a whole lot of understanding.
Yeah.
At least I don't think there is. So, I mean, like, ultimately, just be aware, be observant, you know?
I see.
All right. This was the design question, right? So... MC Prodi or McPrody, I'm sorry. What are some of the best ways to approach or reach some of the bigger studios, specifically in freelance form?
Yana?
It's probably good. I mean, from what I've experienced, probably good if you know somebody at the studio, that helps. but I mean, that's not too much to add. Then if you really want to work at a specific studio, to work towards it, and I've seen people who are, you know, really dedicated to work at a specific studio, and they're basically planning their whole freelance Oh, it was about freelance, right? What I'm talking about.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
sorry, I think I kind of got lost. Like I pulled up the JP now that I don't know what.
Sorry. Sorry. Gotcha.
That's cool.
I feel I'm not really sure if I can answer that because I never actually looked for freelance by myself. Like I was always posting stuff online, and that was the opening for me personally to a bunch of my first freelance jobs, you know? So just posting your work, and usually with the websites nowadays, like ArtStation and stuff, you know, there's people who are looking for talent all the time. You know, that's their job to just look at those sites and find you, basically. So I think just being active and posting will help you to get you to freelance jobs.
I also think that there are some people who are afraid of posting the work because maybe they feel like, oh, it's not good enough.
I can relate to that. Like, I mean, I don't know if you realize, but I just started posting recently again. Like, I have so much work on my computer that I haven't posted because I never felt like, I don't really like it anymore. It's not good enough. So, but right now I'm forcing myself to post more. But, you know, you have to see it as a job. If you're a freelancer, you kind of have to sell yourself. You know, you have to do the marketing for yourself and stuff like this, you know, even if you don't feel like it, it's gonna benefit you probably in some way if you still do it, you know, and post your work, even if you feel like, you know, maybe it's not your best, but maybe, you know, there's some recruiter or art director who's looking at it and might think otherwise, you know, so you never know. And even if not, like, putting your work out there, maybe you will get good feedback from other artists, what you can improve next time. So I think even if I'm really bad at myself doing it, I think it's never a bad thing to you know,
to
upload your work. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I know that for me, I sometimes will reach out to artists that I might find, like, that I like their work. And more often than not, they do give me feedback. And I think that's something I should abuse more, like the kindness of artists, because, like, you get some really good perspective.
It's something to pay forward to, by the way, just so you know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Huh?
Don't just take, give back.
No, absolutely.
Yes, exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All
right.
Yeah. The summary of that is definitely be active, have connections.
Yeah.
And, you know, just keep posting work.
So we're almost hitting, like, the 10-minute mark until it's 12. This went by really quick.
Too quick.
Anything,
we're having fun.
We could have, like, a lightning round of questions to go. Have any.
My page did a refresh. Some people's questions were lost, but I have, like, 5 questions in my list that's left.
Yeah,
okay. So Brainchild TV, shout out to my man. Any tips for landing an internship?
Internship?
I guess this goes to having in studio job.
Yeah, since I've never done that, I'm not sure if I can.
I've never had an internship. I think if you want an internship, again, it helps to play to the audience. Be just like applying to a job. Be as professional as you can, you know? Try to be useful. Like, I don't know. Other than that, I wouldn't really have any good tips necessarily.
I see.
All right. That's cool.
Yeah.
So, Artsuff, question to John, I believe. So, what's up with that comic idea you had these days?
Oh.
Ooh.
It's calling you out.
Oh.
You guys want to see page one?
Absolutely. Whoa, sneaky exclusive stuff, guys.
Yana's seen it, but I mean, if I do that, everybody has to forgive me one thing. I'm temporarily using what is it called? Comic Sans.
Oh, Unforgiven.
No, no.
Bam. End the stream.
Let me see if I can find it.
But I thought the art was so good, you don't even realize. I didn't even realize it was Comic Sans. So.
Oh, fine. You know, whatever. I'll just. It doesn't matter. I will show. I'll show you guys what a couple pages sort of look like in progress.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
But I'm just gonna hide. I'm gonna hide the words.
No.
That way.
See it in its full glory.
With Comic Sans.
All right. Fine. Doing okay. So.
Oh,
okay, this is kind of what it looks like, but I have a lot of pages that are sort of in production, and these are the first two-ish, but...
That's so gorgeous. Are you going to color these?
No, I actually don't want to. I'm keeping it in black and white, because I feel like it's has more of a timeless kind of flavor when it's in black and white. And, you know, I mean, honestly, I work really, really slow on this, because... the level detail is pretty high for me, so I don't know.
That close up of the face, damn.
That's real.
It's a little bit different for me. Again, I'm always trying something different, but I feel like this is the best way to sort of present my IP. Even though the tone of this is different than my actual IP, this is a serious story.
Mm-hmm.
Serious-ish, and my story is much more comedic, absurd, funny, but I feel like I gave myself a more approachable project that was easier to do first, because I like to try and learn before I start, like, trying to, you know, do something with awesome proficiency, because I'm not really very good at a lot of stuff. I mean, especially comic books. Anyway, this is actually, page one is on this side, and page two is on this side.
Ooh.
So,
yeah.
So page one is this one, and page two is this.
Okay.
That's awesome.
Yeah,
it's beautiful. Lovely, thank you for showing this. I feel so privileged right now. Everyone, your eyes been blessed.
I don't know.
Anyone who screen capped that, you're in trouble.
Cyber police are coming.
If you Google Hangout with me, I'm always working on it. So.
Yeah.
Yes.
Especially nowadays.
That's awesome. Oh no, eight minutes. Wait. Enoch, awesome. What other mediums such fields of art do you explore to freshen things up?
Ooh. What other mediums of art? Like
yes.
Cooking.
Yes.
Cooking. Totally cooking.
Ooh. I can make eggs. That's about it. That's good.
You can make, you can like lay eggs.
I can crack eggs. Dude. That's as far as I can go.
You're going to have to show that to Edge Control, man.
That's my presentation. How about you, Anna?
To be honest, besides art, I feel like I can't do anything else, to be honest. I don't have any other talents, but I really do, like, I like to write letters and I like stationery, like, especially... from Japan and kind of stuff I enjoy, so
like calligraphy.
I like stuff like stickers and masking tape, and I don't know if you know that what that is. It's kind of, I feel like
I'm imagining, yeah,
masking tape is awesome, by the way.
Yeah,
masking tape is awesome.
Dude, I haven't posted that yet.
Oh shit, I'm sorry.
That's fine. Uh-huh. I mean, yeah, I've been working, I've done my, like, I'm gonna post that like next week. I've been doing that masking tape. So it's like, I don't know, for the people who don't know, it's like adhesive tape basically with like cute pattern on it, so
okay. And I think I'm getting an image. Okay.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
All right, next one.
Do you like two?
There's
more.
Two left.
Go.
Huh? Yeah, there's two left. Okay. So hi, Jana and JP. What are some ways you guys get yourself out of a rut to level up when you feel like your skill level is at a standstill? I feel like something like this was answered earlier, but a summary.
Like we did that question already.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do something different.
Okay, next question. What do you think makes a successful illustration?
I wish I would know so I could apply it more often.
All right, we're done. Have a good night, everyone.
Well, it's so many different, I think composition is a big part, I guess, you know, like just to have some striking composition that reads in the thumbnail, for instance. It's not too much about the little rendering, it's more about the whole aspect of the illustration. I think that's, yeah. What about you, John?
I'm never going to be happy with anything I do. But if it fulfills the point and tells the story that I'm hoping it does, I feel like that's a victory, you know.
Yeah.
Especially if I learned something in the process. If I feel like, hey, I gained some knowledge, that's enough, you know. I mean, granted, yeah, like if you're doing it professionally, there's a whole other slew of things that you have to make sure are working. It like making specific people happy, you know. Yeah. I mean, that is a huge part of being an illustrator, is making interested parties happy, you know? So, and those can be literally anything, so.
Yeah. I also think from a technical standpoint, the beginning phases of any painting are probably some of the most important, because if you if you have a strong setup, then your render is going to be fine, instead of like figuring things out in the beginning. Faces.
Hey, you know, I was looking at this wonderfully awesome realistic painting today with some of my new coworkers, and the piece that we were looking at, nobody in the room did it, but it was the person who rendered it spent so much time detailing it, and yet they put the head in the wrong spot, attached to the neck, and I'm like, this is why you spend more time in the beginning editing, making sure that the structure is okay.
Yeah.
Because, like, I could tell you for a fact, I have made that exact same mistake, and I beat myself up afterwards because I didn't look for it. You know? I didn't see it.
Yeah.
It's like you can spend so much time on things and then just miss the most obvious thing.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's a good habit to develop, absolutely.
Edit heavy in the beginning.
Yeah. Okay. Oh man, we have 3 minutes left. This went by way too fast. That kind of sucks. That we kind of
cut it short. It was fun. Thanks. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you.
Oops, my mic was muted.
Yeah, welcome. Welcome back.
And thanks everybody in the chat for coming.
Yeah.
Yes.
I agree. Thank you all.
Yes. So
we were going to release some information about the portfolio reviewers.
Oh, true.
But the list is ever growing or reducing here and there, so I can show you a sneak peek of the names we have so far.
Yeah. Are you gonna share
the screen? Don't count on. Yeah, I'm gonna.
Okay.
So
quickly, I'll explain. For this year's event, we don't only have our guest speakers doing portfolio reviews, but we have some people from Toronto and other places coming to do portfolio reviews as well that are also professional artist. John, yourself, is doing portfolio reviews, but we have some local people doing them as well. So we have Crush Visual, some people in the chat. There's Mimir in the chat, also known as Johnny Hall, and Frank Hong from Crush doing portfolio reviews. And Frank actually did a presentation last year with John, which was awesome.
Yep.
And then...
Hey, Frank. Hey, Frank. We gotta hang out when I come back.
Yeah. Buy him a beer. And then we have Northfront Studio, which is a studio in Toronto. They do work for The Expanse and their other things, coming down to do portfolio reviews as well. And they have some amazing work. Ryan and Tim are like incredible with sci-fi. They're incredible with everything, honestly. And then we have, of course, my daddy, Jamaro Kindred, who's coming back this year.
Daddy.
Yeah, so he did a presentation last year, which was awesome. And he's coming back. Yeah, I think he's in the chat too. Hey, Jamaro. So yeah, he's coming down to do portfolio reviews as well. But this list isn't set in stone, like Zavi said. But this is what we have for now. And unfortunately, Jana can't do
maybe
money.
next time.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So quickly before we end, Edge Control again is an event that Zabby and I are hosting this coming August 19th and 20th, where we're bringing these lovely people to come and do presentations and hang out and do portfolio reviews. We'll post some links in the chat to, you know, to get you guys more info. But for now, you gotta get out of here. You gotta leave. This is it.
Thank you for the stream. Honestly, both of you are amazing and beautiful work once again.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Talk again soon.
Yeah. So we'll see everyone later for the next stream. Follow us on Twitch. Follow us on Facebook just to get updated. Yeah. We're out of here. I'm out. Yeah.
Good night.
Night.